high-risk play to get back into the game economically right now.
Let's start over. Welcome, everyone, to the October 2v2 2010 tournament, which, sorry, 2015 tournament, which is a complete gong show at this point since there are hardly any players. I didn't even know there would be a tournament because there were so few players, but apparently there is still one. We have Anakin and Clone versus Sprung and Hokomoko, and me not commentating properly for the first 5 minutes, or not giving you audio for the first few minutes. Sorry about that. I didn't realize the players started up.
And I almost sacked off. Hi everyone, I'm here as well.
Yeah, so that's... So this game started out, as you saw, with the Blast Wing Rush, which we did comment on a bit, which was very powerful, got rid of Clone's commander, leaving Anarchid basically sort of alone. I mean, Clone still has their Amphib Factory, they're not out of the game completely, but yeah, they did take a fair amount of damage from that. At this point,
yeah, it's really the same setup with a scallop drop versus a blast ring rush, and the blast ring rush looks like it did the better job. But they're both using amphib fact, they're both using gunships, so the short sort of rush distance here is why they're doing this sort of cheesy stuff. Also, it's a bit the meta right now.
Oh, it's totally the meta. Amphib and gunship, like amphib is hugely popular. Anywhere where amphib can possibly work, and Isle of Grief is definitely a place where it can work, thanks to the shallow water over here, and over here, in the northwest and southeast. Amphib is super popular regardless, and gunships as well. So this is just the meta. That's just what this is. I'm kind of surprised that Amphib is so popular, though, actually. I can kind of see on maps like this why it's popular, but in general, the popularity is kind of astonishing.
I think a lot of it's the it's the cheese meta as well. Blast wings are common, scallop drops are common, and scallops are the best thing to drop. So you see a lot of Amphibs for that as well.
Yeah, that's true. That is a fair point, and it's... It is... I think, yeah, the scallop drop definitely does tie into it, especially with the gunship. That would make sense. Just that individually, yeah, it's not like, say, scalpels. Where it's like one super powerful unit.
Yeah, but I think that you have a lot of... they're better on short, small maps because they're a relatively slow factory. They have a lot of firepower up close. This is why the scallop's so good to drop. And we see a rapier fight coming up here. But Hokomoko has tridents up, so he doesn't stand much of a chance. He's losing Anarchid's losing his rapiers.
So everything has been set up already, and just at this point... At this point, Anarchid and Clone have their economy very nearly equal, both energy and metal, so it's not... That advantage is not particularly relevant anymore. The early game advantage they got, it's helped. Sprung and Hokomoko haven't been able to get a really nice position thanks to that. But now they're once again into the standard macro game. Well,
they haven't managed to get their energy economy up enough yet to even reclaim the commander rack, though, so they still need to work on getting more energy up and reclaiming that con.
That's true, but if the wind generators go above plus 1.0, in a high wind situation, that con is... And it looks like it already has been reclaimed partially. Next time high winds come up, that con is getting reclaimed. And Anarchid's commander, under no real threat, has the ducks being pushed back. That was... Thankfully not too many ducks wasted. Only 3 ducks. At least they know where everything is now.
Yeah, we see that the sort of territory control is sort of even, but right now... Hokomoko is really pushing back Clon's amphibs. His ducks are no match for the rapiers. Mm-hmm. And Sprung has moved into the middle of the map, taking this island area where right now Hokomoko's gunships are on the mirror side. So they are sort of starting to contest more territory.
Mm-hmm. Anyway. So Anarchid is... Anarchid's actually doing okay. They've got they're the ones basically taking most of the stuff. Clone getting the ducks up, getting the firepower, but a rapier duck versus rapier duck, and loads of duck. Nothing really to deal with it type counter wise. I mean, there's some anglers. There is a scallop, but it's pretty much down to numbers at this point. And red team has the advantage there. Anyway, Sprung is... Well, Sprung's got defenses up, locking down the southeast section. And the northwest section is pretty much also red team. Like, red team going around. It looks like... Is that Hokomoko going around? Yep, Hokomoko looks to be going around, trying to start an air battle in a really bad position with that trident basically hitting a bunch of unsupported rapiers. There are too few numbers to be of any use. Forced to retreat. Chi's attempt completely blocked off. That did not work as well as I'm sure they expected it to. But it looks like Sprung's commander... Is he going to try to push in for an assault? That's a strike commander. The beam laser. That would probably not deal too much damage. We'll see regardless. Planes coming from Hokomoko and... Sprung going for a nuclear silo. Very quick Inferno coming up and... That's... Pretty much going to finish this... Well... That should deal a decent amount of damage. I don't know if it'll necessarily finish this off. I mean, the thing is... It will take something to finish it off. Anarchid and Kluwen are just going to get more and more entrenched. So this isn't a bad idea.
Anarchid and this map does have... It does have fairly large choke points, and the main base is very difficult to get to an assault without going through the rest of the territory, so... yeah, the rush distance via air is small, but the missile silo distance is small as well as a result, so it's a good pick.
Yeah, it's... And the Commander Ruck having been completely reclaimed, at this point Anarchid and Clone with no additional reclaim to work from. And Sprung, not sure what to tack nuke since they don't know what's inside the base. Since they're being honest and clearly not watching the stream. They would know if they were watching the stream what to do, but... And Hokomoko on that. And now they know the answer. Actually, what answer are they going to go? Because it looks like they're... I mean, this seems like it is the one to go for. They should probably go for the units. Going for the base will deal some damage, but there's only one caretaker and a couple wind generators. The solar collectors would be closed, but there's not much to hit. Whereas smashing this up would basically open up everything to the ducks, allowing Sprung and Hokomoko to finish the job. With their units, I mean.
We see an Arcad and Klon trying to make a breakout with the amps on the left, but Sprung's getting into position with his own, yeah, to flank him with his ducks.
And it looks like, yeah, okay, I mean, with all the ducks, 27 ducks compared to, I mean, the scalps are going to be a threat. That's a huge problem. This is what I was talking about before, I mean, it's all the ducks. At the time, there was no type counter, but now the three scallops, that completely stops Sprung from stopping that. Like, at this point, Anarchid and Klon actually have a bit of a way out to deal some damage, thanks to those scallops.
Yeah, and Hokomoko's really let his rapier count fall, and he's switched to ravens at this point as well, so that means that Anarchid's getting an advantage in rapiers if he can use that for anything.
Yeah, I'm surprised the ravens have... I don't know, are they using the ravens to try to strategically strike something? Because at this point, they could have hit quite a few metal extractors and taken a lot of that out.
I think along with the Inferno TAC nukes, which there are now three of, they're trying to end the game all at once.
Yeah, so Commander Kill is coming up very short. Or what is it? Well, I mean, there was Hokomoko going for the Commander Kill, but now just Metal Extractors.
Did they have intel on the Commander?
Yeah, they knew the Commander was over in the southeast. They were targeting it. The bombers were going over to the southeast exactly where Anarchid's Commander was. Or still is. Didn't really do much
there. Maybe he's decided to clear up for these docks, you know, so the docks can go in. But he targeted the Metal Extractors,
yeah,
which the docks could get anyway, rather than the... Yeah, here comes the Infernos, all over the map.
Yeah, this... Yeah, rather than make the choice, just hit everything and hope for the best, which I think will actually work fairly well. Anarchid's Commander gonna go down. Not that it's a big deal at this point in the game, though it does mean the southeast will be destroyed without much to rebuild it. The ducks tearing apart everything here, that scallop going down, and with that, the Amphib Factory is gonna be destroyed too. The southeast is gone, the main base is heavily damaged, and... Anarchid and Klon resign, game one. Very nice opening from Sprung and Hokomoko with that last wing rush. And Klon not ready to go. Whoa, okay.
I think Klon's barely been hit, and Arcad's had, you know, he's been basically gutted, but Klon's been, he's just broken back through on the left side, so he feels really confident now, like he can take a lot of territory, he's broken through, he has a lot of boys set up in position, he can defend and keep playing, but Anarch has just taken too much damage, and unless he can take out that He's got some ducks in position on the missile silo, so we'll see whether he can take it out.
It looks like it's not going to do much. No, not much.
No,
all
not
those
enough.
Ducks have no power to get rid of that. And at this point, once again, they're kind of locked into their base. Defense is already set up, and Sprung's force is already in place. The angler's using up a lot of that being a lot of that army. Meaning there isn't a whole lot of army that could actually deal with the ducks easily.
Yeah, both players have built tridents and anglers enough that the gunships are not really as effective as they could be. So Hokomoku switching into planes, which have more maneuverability and can dodge and hit where they need to. And switching out of rapiers was probably also a good idea.
Yeah, that was a really good choice. Not an easy one either, because they've already gone for gunships. They're going both air factories. It's not a common choice. But it was definitely the correct one.
I think switching into a land factory as well would have been good. But yeah, switching out of rapiers is probably the better choice, yeah.
I mean, it did allow
them to see
what's
going on. Yeah, switching
into
cloak is
good. You need to have that intel.
Yeah, switching factories either way is probably a fair call. Whereas Anarchid's gunships now are just sort of sitting in the back and not being very useful because there's just too much AA on the map.
Yeah, that brawler especially, that's a lot of money thrown in the back. I mean, both that and the rapier, I mean, that's easily 2,500 metal worth of just scrap metal at this point. It's doing nothing. But now
here
the taxi, there we go, assault. New silo is now going down. Surprisingly, it wasn't building much, but I guess Sprung didn't really care about it anymore. It did its job. I mean, it really did do its job. That's the thing. It's down, but it broke everything else, so I don't really know where... I don't know how much effect that's going to have, but probably not going to be too much.
Yeah, I think we do see that Klon is taking out quite a lot of forces. He can sweep through, as long as he doesn't die to these incoming ducks on the left, he can sweep through all this expansion and take out quite a bit of Strong's economy. But he's going through the left side, which that's a bit of a shame, actually.
You mean the right side?
No, he seems to be going left to intercept the ducks rather than going towards the right to take out the economy. Which he could probably easily do.
Maybe, but it's at this point not happening. At this point, Klon going back for defense.
Yeah, here we see Anarchid as well bringing his gunships, and he needs to take out that Razor's Kiss if he's going to be operating this area. But he can defend against these glaives.
Well, I mean, the scallop's already there. That's going to be able to manage most of the glaives, really. Like, this pure raider strategy coming from Red Team is pretty easily stuffed. And down goes the Razor's Kiss, opening up the gunships, and that's going to be a much harder thing to deal with. Yeah, at this point, a comeback might be in the cards.
Yeah, they're looking pretty well. They're really taking a lot of territory and reclaiming a lot. I think on this map, as long as you can sort of contest the middle zones, you can take your own zones fairly easily because there is a lot of choke points. And the gunships are being useful again as well.
Yeah, so the center east expansion down, counterattack coming in from the west side where there's basically no defense. Could be effective, but basically it's a matter of speed. However, in terms of speed, Red Team will win out.
Rapiers they one-shot glaives, rapiers, so they can be quite good against them. So yeah, he's pulling back. With that in the brawler, it's a very good defensive force. It's hard to assault into.
Yeah, it kind of sucks they stopped building air at all. I mean, they have the Hawk and not much else, as Red Team does. Blue Team, on the other hand, kept their gunships alive. They really did keep everything around. They haven't... Or they stopped production. Anarchy, it hasn't really been producing that much recently, but still.
He's been making brawlers because there's so much AA in the area.
True,
he wants something that's a bit beefier and has more range.
It's just not making them continuously. That's the thing. And making them from time
to time. Yeah, he has paused production now. Yeah.
But yeah, given that Red Team now is in a tough position.
They're still ahead on economy, but all their game finishing power, their bombers, their
nuke silo.
Silo and everything, it's all been taken out, so they really have to sort of recapitulate and see what they can do with these snipers, I suppose, which I guess are to take on the boys.
Yeah, so that's gonna be an issue. That's gonna be... I think this fight's gonna turn it around. Like, given the unit composition, given the way that blue team has been playing, and the way red team's been playing, this looks like it's gonna finish it. Nice placement on the tick, but unfortunately got spotted too soon. And those brawlers just tearing right at the boys. Nothing can really deal with that easily. That's on the blue team. Sorry, the red team at least. Blue team just has this.
Yeah, they have. He has one fighter, one trident, I think. The snipers can actually take out the brawlers if they're targeted well, which I think is what he's going for now.
That's exactly it, but they're too easy to spot out, too. I mean, got lucky there. That one sharpshooter nearly got spotted. But still, it's...
Glaives to the left again, rapiers to intercept.
Yeah, and over on the eastern side, another attack coming in, and those glaives... At least breaking open the static defense. And the west eastern side. Oh, okay, small expeditionary force did get destroyed, but... Yeah, map's pretty stabilized at this point, pretty even.
Yeah, Anarka's putting up a huge line of defenders here, I suppose, to contain the glaives. Also, they're a bit stronger versus snipers, because it takes a lot... You're wasting a lot of damage on a defender, but they're terrible versus boys. I mean, relatively bad, I'd say.
Yeah, the boys can easily tank it. That's not a problem. Although, unfortunately, did not see where the defenders actually were, apparently, because a lot of the ducks just hitting them head-on rather than hitting the line on the side. Causing them to take far more damage than they absolutely need to, and more brawlers coming in, which can't have nothing to counter them. Well,
yeah, it's
Razor,
down to the snipers, but they can't do the DPS to get through three brawlers.
No,
Glaives trying to take on the boys, but there's too many scalpels there, I think, and too many brawlers.
Yeah, the only hope is that the scalpels end up destroying a bunch of the boys as well, but that's not happening.
No, the AoE from the brawlers. Three brawlers, that's enough. When they're that tightly packed, brutal.
Yeah, that's painful.
More raiding along the left side. He's got
the
economy now.
Coming in for support, too.
Tridents, yeah, that's what he needs.
Getting rid of the... Oh, Black Dawn will be coming in to help out, but if the Tridents come into position, and it looks like it has been spotted out well enough, so... Yeah. The Glaives are pretty much free to damage stuff until the Ducks come along, and that's... That will stop the party. But even then, those were pretty good raids. It's just, those were only metal raids. It just so much energy that needed to be destroyed. That wasn't. Broke the overdrive chain, but not very well. That'll be easy to rebuild. But at this point, Shieldbot, proxy Shieldbot factory, and... Oh. Anarka getting the... Well, actually, they still have... Or getting another Amphib plant out. Getting the Grizzly out. Going for the Game Ender. While red team continuing to go for early mid-game strategies, going for into Grizzly themselves, but for the most part going for heavy, heavy raiders, which have already gotten their tight counters in play.
Anarka's working on a crow, I suppose, to bust things open, but it's like 10 minutes, given his current economy,
crow
which is not nearly as good. Yeah, it's not nearly as strong as the northern team.
And the Black Dawn down, so that will open up raiding possibilities. No, it doesn't look like anything's set up. I was about to say, I don't think that Hokomoko is set up to capitalize on that. But, at least it's gone, I guess. And that crow is still in production. Alright. A little surprising, I must say. It's like, kind of rare that you see both a grizzly and a crow being built up at the same time. And the sharpshooter's down, that's anti-air down. Until the tridents get in position.
Yeah, it's relying heavily on tridents, which is a fair plan. They're fast, and their only vulnerability is that they can be taken out via ground-based AA. So you can take them out quite at a fair bit of range, but since he doesn't have any other air units, ground-based AA is not... There's not much ground-based AA that Klon is fielding right now.
Yeah, and there, the Glaives still trying to get in, not able to do anything thanks to a well-placed Sky Dust. Like, all the time with the Glaives, it's just, I don't understand why Hokomoko insists on going for Glaives. It's well past the time where that's useful. Actually, one thing I'm kind of surprised is that Hokomoko has not gone Amphib, given that Hokomoko loves going Amphib.
I think he wants factory diversity, and it's a fair idea. The snipers are a good pick, but I'd use scythes or something to spot for them and defend them, rather than using the big glaive slobs. I think he's thinking that they might be good against the boys, but they're terrible against rapiers, they're terrible against scallops, they're not even that good against ducks.
Yeah, at that point... And their scythes are up, but yeah, for
Cloaky he does have scythes,
Amphib, what would you even use? I mean, Zeus are too slow, warriors are too weak, Rocko's might work okay, but that's kind of risky.
It's snipers. Snipers are really good against boys. They can just pick them off and do that high alpha damage one at a time, picking off one after another after another. You need to cede territory to do that.
Yeah, but
it's big assault coming on boy versus boy.
Yeah, the problem with sharpshooter, of course, is the reload time, so that's not the best option, all things considered.
Yeah, you pick them off one at a time. It looks like, it looks like Klon has really completely destroyed Sprung's Amphib Force. And he's going to reveal a sniper as well.
Yeah, and that wasn't even... Hokomoko wasn't even paying attention to that. Going in with a scythe, trying to get whatever damage they can, but that's not happening. Or at least, if it does, it's not going to matter. At this point, it's too late.
Yeah, here we see the Boilers coming in. They need to avoid that Razor's Kiss, which they're not doing, but other than that, they're doing quite well. The first, there's a Grizzly up, which is being given to Klon.
And in with a Scout.
There's Grizzlies from both sides.
No. Sides, I mean. No, this is clearly going for Blue Team. There's nothing much being built up in behind for the Yellow Team. The Crow is just about done. The Grizzly has been finished for some time. It's moving along. And that's overall... Okay, there's some economy damage, but at this point, Blue Team just has such an army that the economy damage that's been dealt isn't much.
I think that this Grizzly is going to be very hard to displace, and when the Crow gets up, the Red Team has a big economic advantage still. I mean, it's not huge, but it's significant enough, I think, that once they finally finish their big production efforts, such as the Crows and the Grizzlies, they're going to pull back ahead. But Klon and Anarchid are putting up an excellent fight here and really making really good cost with their armies.
Mm-hmm. Wait, are Klon and Anarchid blue or red to you?
Anarchid and Klon are blue to me. Are they
not
to you?
Good. They are blue to me.
Yes,
double check. They are blue to me. Yeah, so that one Grizzly, but still. It's just that one Grizzly is the only thing that the Northern team has.
The Northern team has like double the economy right now. They're doing really well. The Southern team's running basically off of reclaim, I think, at this point. And an army which is very difficult to dislodge. The Crow is finally up now. It's coming out, and I think it's going to... It will probably do a lot of damage. The Southern team is mostly given up on AA.
Oh! I missed that. Yes, Crows are being built on both sides. Okay.
Oops. Both sides, yeah.
My mistake. I was thinking you were talking about Anarchid's Crow. Just,
no.
Anarchid's Crow's halfway done. What are you talking about? No, apparently Sprung and Hokomoko were ahead of the game on that one. Sheesh.
Yeah, they had more economy to do this, and they can. He can try and hit this with Brawlers, which can do the work. He can try and sort of scramble up some AA, but you need a lot of AA to kill a Crow before it retreats and repairs. And it's a very slow, sort of grindy way to do this, to sort of retreat and repair and retreat and repair. But it will win in the end, and it's gotten the reclaim field. We can see these two air constructors in the rear working on this
reclaim?
Huge reclaim field.
6,000
reclaim. Yeah, it's very difficult.
Wow.
This is what Klon were running up their economy off, and now there's this Crow sitting in the reclaim field, so it's going to be... Ooh, he's risking it.
That Crow is pretty much dead.
Oh, it's having troubles.
Grizzly in for support, but is it going to it does survive. 4,000 health left.
Trident's at the last second.
Where
yeah,
are
the
those
Trident's
cranes?
At the last second.
Those cranes desperately need to come to the front lines here and repair.
I think they're just reclaiming at this point. This is what has been keeping Anarchid and Klon alive, is all this reclaim. And now Sprung with and Hokomoko, with a stronger economy, have control of this reclaim field.
Well, for now. If that gets dislodged at all, but then, the cranes coming in... How much... Like, they're taking... Yeah, they're taking easily about 30 metal every second. Which is... Well, that is what they're taking. 30 metal a second. Anarchid and Klon still have something going on there. Yeah, they're not giving it up very easily.
Klon is spamming land AA now, which dislodges the Tridents and the Crow both. So as long as they can use the brawlers to deal with this grizzly, they might be able to take territory back, especially if they can come around the side right now as they are and kill all these constructors.
Well, that's one down, two down. The other four are basically going to go down. Three down.
And yeah, the AA is coming around.
Are the rest of them being saved? That grizzly. The grizzly finally gaining position. Fourth down. All but one of the cranes goes down from that reclaim, but that reclaim was still more than worth. All the cranes down. Every crane dies, but that was still easily 2,000 metal. I'm pretty sure, because it was draining pretty fast.
The crow is almost up for an arcade. It's got less than a minute.
Yep.
There are so many tridents that I'm not sure what it can do unless they really make as Clon really steps up his ground AA.
Mm-hmm. And those Banshees just itching for something to attack, and they have targets. They have a lot of economic targets they could go for. Going for the main base,
the main base now.
Ooh, that'd be devastating. Really good timing.
Yeah. Just snipe out the AA and then free reign. And he doesn't have any tridents himself or much land AA. Yep. The land AA is out of position, it would need to go all the way around.
This could clinch it.
Oh, this is so devastating. This is so bad for the crow.
They're not hitting the gunship plant.
That's good-ish, I guess.
Well, that's true. It's a high risky thing to hit the gunship
plant. Here comes
plant.
The AA, finally.
But that's still too many Banshees. That
it's
crow
not
is...
Oh, the crow's! The crow is finally up! Is it going to be able to do anything?
And the crow is... still up?
Oh my god! Oh my god,
that's what I said.
Should have
gone for the gunship plant. If you go for the gunship plant, it would kill off the crow immediately, as soon as the gunship plant was dead. And the gunship plant would die real quick.
5% hit points there.
And
here come all the tridents,
to finish it off.
They're going to take out the brawlers. But he'll be able to retreat with his crow into safe territory, but the brawlers are gone down, which is difficult. Here comes the crow from the other team as the backup for the tridents. That's going to be really difficult.
This should
I don't think he has
it.
Enough AA here. I suspect so.
I can't see how they could get out of this. I mean, the Infernos were something to get out of because there was the entire southwest side that was not touched.
A wall of Roccos coming in here too, on the land.
Okay, well, that, like I said, Roccos are the other option, and that does seem to be working pretty well. Although the Ducks doing a number on them. Band is doing a big number on them. More just the numbers that are making it an actual problem. There's just enough Roccos, they don't need to care. And now Clone throws in the towel, and that is game one. Sprung and Okamoko proving that they actually do have a mid to late game. They aren't just cheese. They have mid game.
I gotta say, really impressive though how long the blue team held on. They held on and had a military advantage for a long time on sometimes half the economy. So impressive play from both teams.
Mm-hmm. So next game is gonna be on whatever map Clone and Anarchid choose. Knowing them, probably of course gonna be Comet Catcher or Red Comet. I mean, they are ones for their macro play. So, what are we going to be playing on? And apparently Anarchid actually knew about the Blastwings coming in. They just hadn't actually decided to do anything about it. Which is a very strange strategy. Clearly, it didn't work especially well. But we'll see.
Yeah, you do need to react to Blastwings. The problem is they're so difficult to scout. Unless you're like using Blastwings or something yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, so when is this going to start up? Next game. Yeah, so Anarchid and Clone, they'll figure it out. But yeah, it's their map choice. Casting. Alright, so we are on to Titan Duel. That is Clone's pick of map. Interesting pick.
I mean, very sort of standard flat map choice here. Expect something like a vehicle mirror, unless we see more gunship cheese, maybe hovercraft or tank.
I'm sure we'll see something gunshipy. It's two players. And we're getting more into the typical, or at least what you expected a long time ago, from this game when it came to team games, which is, of course, one player goes air. That's been happening.
Yeah, only it's gunship now. Since the Raven nerf, it's all everything's been about the gunship rather than the plane factory. And gunship play is very different. It's much more all or nothing. I mean, not just with the blast wing cheeses, but the fact that you can have a gunship which sticks around and continues to do damage in an area. You don't have that time when a bomber hits you and it does really significant damage, but then it goes back and you have time to scramble and get up AA for the next time it comes around. With a gunship, it can just keep killing you and keep sniping out any attempt you make to build AA. So, yeah, it's a lot more all or nothing in that way.
Oh, yeah, totally. I'm just thinking in terms of... What am I thinking in terms of? I think in terms of the... Just the fact that have the transports, you have...
The counter mechanics as well, in that, you know, you need to build AA to fight against one player, but you need to build land forces to fight against the other player. So, sort of striking that balance, and then a player can suddenly just drop and abandon their air force and pump everything into land units, and suddenly you're being overwhelmed, or vice versa. If you don't build quite enough AA, suddenly all these banshees come out of everywhere and swamp over you. So, sort of that switching between one domain and the other, swapping back and forth to exploit where the enemy's weakest,
is
something you can do really well in Tibbers 2.
Yes, that's a lot easier in 2v2. It's harder to know when to switch in 1v1, but knowing actually doing it right's a great mix up. Like if you know it's okay, that way.
Yeah, with cooperation, you can even pump metal into one factory over the other. Like, you can start with a scallop drop or a blast wing cheese or something, and then just get the commander to assist the other factory, turn the air factory off. Or vice versa, get both commanders to assist one factory. The air factory at the start, then go in with rapiers or blast wings or whatever, and then switch entirely to land forces. So do this really early on, where you're switching, doing one really heavily, and then doing the other really heavily.
Yeah, well, it is one of the things about team games too, is like I said, the build power thing.
Yeah, we really expected more of that. I mean, this is why we have Facplop. Is this used to be the thing in team games?
With
is what
boosting,
you did is you.
Yeah.
Was you put all your economy into one guy and you got out like a Goliath or a crow or something stupid.
Yeah, I wasn't here for that, but really Facplop to me defines so much of 0K. It's kind of surprised it worked without it. Just like that to me is a huge part of what makes 0K 0K is that you just basically have your factory. Like it's almost like a faction
choice.
It's almost
like It is, and it's important to have, but it's just that you need the meta to be developed enough for players to go, oh, hey, with enough cooperation, we can actually do something ridiculous here. And this is something that team play meta in general is not that well developed, even though there's lots of team games. Players haven't really figured out how to break the game in certain ways. So it took a long time for us to sort of go, okay, Facplop's the way... It didn't take that long for us to go, Facplop's the way to go. But, you know, we tried a lot of different systems, and it was definitely the one. But you can still do it with the other half of your metal, your starting metal. You know, you don't have all of your starting metal available, unless you want to reclaim your factory. But even then, you don't get the full refund on that.
And that would be sort of doable, but then you still have to get a worker to reclaim the factory with, and that would slow things down regardless.
Yeah, right now it makes some sort of cooperating on one factory interesting rather than mandatory.
Yes. Right, so looks like they're expecting okay, so Anakin and Clone expecting cheese and Sprung and Hokomoko expecting scallops. So they basically figure that everyone's going to play the exact same way they played before. Which will be interesting if they do, but I don't think so. This map, with the way the rush distances work on this map and the fact that you start in a corner, it's much more defensible. Gunships make sense, but early scallop drop, kind of tricky. Anakin going for heavy... No, sorry, Clone going for heavy tanks. Anakin for light vehicles. Ground play coming out of blue team. Red team going pretty heavily for... Scallop... Are they... Is red team going for scallop drop? I think might be. Well, Hokomoko doing...
Yeah, there's... This is old meta versus new meta. This is, you know, the last wave, which was all tank vehicle combos, versus the new meta, which seems to be amph gunship combos.
Yeah, which means we're going to be able to really test this out. And Scallop Drop is indeed Hokomoko and Sprung we're worried about and what they're indeed doing. And...
You can see exactly what I'm talking about, though. The assisting of one factory, because the transport's a lot cheaper. So they pump all the metal into the scallops to get one transport per scallop. Works really well, actually.
Yeah, because it's 80 metal for 220. Yeah, that does work. But at this point, they have no stored metal left. They're going for it. Three scallops onto a base full of vehicles. This is going to be interesting. These things, it's so much dependent on position. And this is going to be much more all-in than that initial blast wing rush.
Support and recon commanders, not the best choice. Maybe
that's death. That's game. We're moving on to game three.
Wow! What happened? Did he bounce off the top of the factory?
I don't think so. I think it's just they got hit. Like, the defenders hit them, the Kodachi hit them. Like, there's two Kodachis in the way. And the defender... And maybe they hit the factory on the way down, like after the gunship. Probably after the transport was destroyed, one of the scallops hit the factory and immediately died.
Yeah, I think they bounced off the top of the factory. There's two little scallop debris here, which were just destroyed. And then at close range, which is where the scallop excels, the Scorcher excels even more. Mm-hmm. The scallop sort of will counter the Scorcher, but if he doesn't have enough time to really get his weapons to bear, the Scorchers just mess them up. Wow, that was just a metal delivery service.
That was amazing. I think Hokomoko felt bad about the last game, that he won the last game. It's like, you didn't have economy last game. Here, have metal on us.
I don't understand how... There was one defender, and... How did they even die?
I don't know. It was one of those times I wish Zero K had a way of, like, something like Planetary Annihilation's Chrono Cam, and I could just go back and see what the hell just happened.
That was so bad. That was, like, the worst scallop drop I've ever seen.
I don't think you could make a worse scallop drop if you tried. That was unfortunate. That was extremely unlucky.
Versus the old school meta, which is, like, hard expand, like, tons of raiding, you know, into like this huge tank push down your face. I don't think that. I'm not sure they can recover.
Well, I mean, they have cranes. That's one thing they do have on their side is very, very rapid expansion in every single direction at once. But at this point, they're playing heavy defense. I mean, Hokomoko and Sprung are playing heavy defense. Anakin and Klon wide open. I mean, this is dream situation for heavy tank and light vehicles. Like, you don't have to worry about any attacks. You just go around and deal with everything. You just build everything you need. You move everywhere you need to.
You raid and expand.
This is living the dream. Yeah, like, Anakin and Klon are living the dream. And Sprung and Hokomoko are... If they come back from this, I'm going to be extremely impressed. Because they're against Anarchid and Klon combined, and they put themselves back at the first minute of the game.
I think we just can almost sit back here and just appreciate how fast Anarchid and Klon are just gobbling up the map.
There's nothing to worry about. It's just, we have map. We'll take map. You clearly aren't using this, so we'll just take it. I should say to Sprung and Hokomoko. Because Sprung and Hokomoko clearly are not using it. They're just stuck in the base. And this should finish the game. And Blastwings are coming but that's not going
to
be enough.
I want to see if Blastwings... Blastwings is meant to be so good at the start of the game. I don't want to see if they're any good against Raiders and stuff. Oh, here goes the Commander.
Yeah, Hokomoko's Commander down. Kodachi's coming in to finish everything. Well, Kodachi's in the rear. But, you know, deal some damage.
Turning off the factory as well, which is cute. That's something you don't see very often from Kodachis, is that just the same way Inferno missiles can, they can turn off a factory.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly with raiding with Kodachis, you just see the one shot on the mechs and they get out of there, but if they do get into the factory, they can set it burning for quite a while.
And that is going to be up to game three. But hey, valiant effort on Hokomoko and Sprung's part after that first cheese failed.
Yeah, well, it was down to the cheese, really. I mean, that's what it was all about, I think. I think if they had made that work.
They have mid-game. We saw their mid-game is real. Like, I don't know why they were so focused on cheese. They can play the we've seen them play the macro game.
I think you've got to get that. If you get that initial, like, with a scallop drop, you get that initial, like, bit of damage. You can then slow push into the middle of the map. Because you can't, you're slow as amps. It's what they are. They move slowly. It's sort of the factory theme is they're sort of heavier and move a bit more slowly. So having that, you know, versus something like vehicles and tanks, which expand really quickly and move really quickly, you need to sort of set the enemy really behind and set the pace of the game slower. And set them to sort of that they need to sit in their base and reclaim more and rebuild more so they're not expanding quite as aggressively. And then you can slow expand and they can slow expand and you're on a more even footing.
Yeah.
I think on a map like that, you almost need some kind of gambit, a bit of a gambit. I think especially if you're starting gunships, you don't need to necessarily do a scallop drop. But something, you know, it can be a rapier rush, a blast wing rush, or something like that. Although blast wing rushes, I find, super obnoxious.
Yeah, but I mean, it's a question of how. I think blast wings, are they still shrapnel based? I can't remember. Or did that change to just area damage? Because I don't use them very much myself.
They have a bit of both. Like they do have. Okay. They still do have the air explosion, and they do a fair amount of shrapnel damage. But it's the shrapnel's just random anyway, so it's just sort of spread in front of them.
That's what I mean. Like blast wings are a bit random and a bit weird to deal with because of that. I mean, I've found, like, they seem to work okay watching it. Like, sometimes they work, sometimes they don't, but it's hard to tell whether or not they will, so I think for a lot of people, it's just, it seems obnoxious because you might throw up your defenders, and it might work in one game, and then the next game, they get lucky, and your entire defender line goes down. Like, one blast wing kills it.
I used to do this years ago. In fact, I don't know if I'm to blame for the current round of blast wings, but I'm to blame for the last time they were nerfed. Last time they were nerfed, I started doing this on that the map with the high cliffs and the sea surrounding it. What was that one? What is that one called?
Ravaged?
Ravaged, yeah. I started doing it on that map as just every single time I played that map.
You'd ring around their base and then come in on all sides at once.
And people were like, what is this? Blast rings are usable? Because this is a tactic I've been using for like years, way back, and I break it out every now and again. You know, one of us breaks it out, you know,
me or Google
or something. And I broke it out, and it just infected the meta, and everyone started doing it. It's like, wow, and everyone started doing it on every map. So we nerfed blast wings and toned them down, but Google still needs some convincing on this round, whether they're abusive or they're OP at the moment. So sort of he's watching these games and he wants more games like this where you can see them being used. And yeah, I think it's not so much that they're OP, they can fail sort of thing, but when they work, it's just makes the game a bit dumb.
It feels terrible.
We've looked at a lot of times.
It does feel pretty bad, and also it's just, like I said, kind of random. It's hard to know whether or not it'll work, but it's random based on the shrapnel explosion. Not random based on, well, my opponent might be placing their defenses here or here or here or in this configuration. What am I supposed to do? And not knowing
if you
what's
run into
there.
If you run into a defender, sort of after it's built up and it has a clear shot on you, you just blow up and sort of scatter uselessly shrapnel at him. And so there is that, but that's blind. You know, it's not random. I mean, it is where the enemy plays their defenders, and they can be very clever, and they can expect a blast wing rush from this angle.
Blind is part of it. Blind is part of it, but the other part of it is the shrapnel explosion is still random. So if they're close enough when that defender hit, they still smash the defender, and then the next blast wings would come in. Like, if they got lucky with the shrapnel.
Yeah. I think sometimes you can see this. I think you've commentated a lot of blast wing rush games in the last while, which is a bit like, Jesus, is it this big in the meta? That's kind of unfortunate.
Well,
but a few times you can see
many.
The players.
What I've seen is a couple of attempts to do blast wing rushes which have totally failed. Flipstep really likes doing them and is much better at defending them as far as I've seen than doing them. Like I've seen them try two or three times without really making it work, and I've seen them defend it once perfectly. So
that's the thing. I don't think they're that OP. I just think that when they work, they just, you know, it's just that even players trying to use it versus a superior player and losing anyway is actually not as good for the game either, because they could try and play conventionally and maybe learn something from losing its superior player. So being the go-to cheese, having a cheese like that, this is something that
all cheeses are like that.
StarCraft 2, StarCraft, exactly, the StarCraft photon cannon rush. You know, even if it's not good, and good players know how to beat it. The fact it's there as what a bad player who is a bit cheeky does versus a good player to try and sneak a win, you know, the fact that it exists as that makes those matchups less fun to play, you know? Although, the fact that those sorts of cheeses exist?
Yeah, although a lot of that is just the nature of RTS, is that there's the win condition is pretty simple. Especially in the early game, the win condition is super simple because there's only one or two things to destroy. If you can destroy those things, you've won. Like, I'm just thinking, say, fighting games for comparison, you can't do that because you still have to get all of their health. I mean, you might get lucky in a startup and there's a couple games where you can, if you get lucky in a startup, then do like three or four combos in a row and win and do a mix-up between each combo to keep it going. Like, Skullgirls allows you to do that. Most fighting games don't even allow you to do that. So, RTS is kind of in this weird space there where the first couple minutes of the game, there's that... Well, for 0K, first 30 seconds. But for the first little while of the game, there's this huge vulnerability where you can just get hit by one thing and it shuts you down completely and you lose the game. So
it's because you both grow at exponential speeds.
Yeah, exactly.
Rather than sort of starting out with full hit points, you both have to grow at the same speed rather than like doing equal amounts of damage to each other. You have to... If one person gets an asymmetrical amount of damage, they get put back on the sort of this exponential curve. And it is a really weird thing. It's one of the reasons why starting with a commander is really good, because it's self-defending. Why, you know, we have fact plop, so, you know, you can get your factory down really fast, and we gave the factory a lot more hit points. Like, it used to be much more snipeable.
And that does help.
It helps a lot, but... It's why we've also stomped on Blastwing several times, and we're talking right now about, like, what is a Blastwing meant to do then? Like, I actually originally designed the Blastwing as the raider in the factory. Its whole reason is you do not have a raider in that factory. And every factory needs a raider, this thing, is you don't have anything that goes in there and takes out a few metal extractors at the start of the game to put the enemy behind. Here we go, have the game starting up now?
But... not much. I mean, Klogi and Jumbot versus Shield and Amphib. Well, Hokomoko playing Amphib, of course.
Much more standard game.
Yeah, this will probably actually be a pretty decent game. Though Baron can turtle up hard. But with Jumbots in play, I don't think that'll happen too easily. The moderators could cause that. But...
very early moderator, I think, versus these docks. I think he's an interesting choice.
I agree with it.
Yeah, ducks are a little...
it'll one-shot, I think. Oh yeah, totally one-shots ducks. And the ducks are slow enough, it won't be a big deal.
Now, ducks are slow and expensive. Yeah, they're like 5 more than bandits, so yeah.
Yeah, moderators one-shot ducks. Ducks are expensive enough that it's harder to... well, they're heavy enough, it's harder to get through them. And then, of course, there's glaives for extra support. So, that seems like a pretty solid strategy.
He's using it with his commander right now. He needs to stop the enemy from closing, but he has the commander with the jump as well.
And heavy
to stop
gun.
Any sort of single... he's already upgraded. Yeah, cool. So, yeah, he's clearly using his commander as a riot to support his... and that's the one thing. We saw this. God did this all the time. He'd use his commander as a riot unit because a spider factory would lack proper riots other than the venom. And then he'd upgrade a flea to warrior and stuff. And so... this factory also, Jump for Bot, also really lacks a proper riot. So he's doing the same thing here, and Klon rather is doing the same thing, where he's using Commander as a riot to support his strong skirmishes.
Which, well, seems to work pretty well.
Ooh, a scythe going down to it. Ooh, just missed it.
Well, it got one duck. The scythe actually did get a duck, so there is that. Pretty much for free, too. That was a nice shot.
Plon skipping pyros or puppies and going straight to this moderator spam, which is really interesting, sort of building up the skirmisher ball. Which, it's great to see sort of a player able to do that, to go straight to sort of skip the raider phase on a smaller map a little bit.
Well,
ooh, a commander
assault
there coming
Anakin's
on the
bottom, handling the raider
bottom
phase.
Left.
Yeah, Sprung opening that true. Up. Nicely done, almost taking no damage in the process.
Yeah, taking damage really on his commander, but... hopefully he can hear that. He's got a lot of bandits there, too much to break through, so he's not in any danger.
Well, the scythe is going to come in. It looks like Anarchid's probably going to try to get around, at least get behind the commander, because the commander can't do much. Shouldn't be able to get in too hard, though. Those bandits will easily decloak it. That scythe, so worried about getting spotted, and gets past it. The bandits do not see it. Another band coming in, just dodging all of them. Nice attack.
He's going
though.
For the commander. I don't think he has much chance. Yeah, no, he's going for the economy. The commander, it's already upgraded, has a beam laser, has turrets around it. So he's just trying to get in for the economy, maybe take out the raider or something here.
Well, it looks like they're just breaking in. They're trying to get everything they can with the bandits they have. I guess bandits are pretty good, and actually, these are enough bandits. With the duck support, the Anarchist commander is pretty much dead unless more support comes in, and...
Yeah, he has jump. He can get away. Ooh.
Sword
he didn't jump
get away.
Up the hill. Yeah, he needs to keep...
Not well enough.
Is he stuck? Is he stuck?
I think so. Yeah, those ducks gonna have a field day with that... Ah, commander's down. Knocked out of position. Got unstuck, but that commander's still dead. So that... Once again, more damage for Hokomoku and Sprung. Taking out Anarchid... Well, taking out a commander early on. Fifth of the economy. Fairly powerful attack. But then there's also this follow-up, which is very nice.
Wow.
But there's no... I think there's enough support. Yeah, there's no support easily. This is a bit of damage, but it's all reclaimed. But no, it looks like Anakin and Toad throwing in the towel.
I think
with the northeast attack as well. In fact, that they lost the center-west expansion. So Anakin has been throwing in the towel fairly quickly. I think Clone will probably hold on. No, Clone decides to go with it.
Yeah. He lost the other commander. I'm not sure what to.
Okay, Hokomoku and Sprung take the winner's finals, but they're still grand finals, so I guess Anarchid and Clone get another shot. If they can win two in a row, then... I don't know if we're going to do that. But if we do, then Anarchid and Clone, if they win two in a row, will, like, win two sets in a row, will win. But Hokomoku and Sprung only have to win one set. After this.
Yeah, that was a super interesting game, because bandits and ducks are quite good against glaives, really. So relying on glaives is your only raider force, and then he switches into scythes, which puts him behind on sort of raider force. And so when that huge force of raiders came through and all he had to defend it was these slow skirmisher forces.
Yeah.
He needed like warriors or a factory with sort of stronger combat raiders, like bandits himself or... maybe. I don't know.
Yeah,
shame. The moderator thing didn't work, because I mean it was doing so well whittling him down, but that big ball of maybe having ticks in place would be really good. That is how Cloakbot gets the edge up on these longer ranged, slightly heavier raiders. It once they get up to a large enough number where they sort of have that almost a skirmisher like effect of snowballing against glaives, you can tick them and get that advantage back that way. That would have worked there. It's nice to have a tick near your commander. So if you get bum rushed, you can just tick
it. That would have actually probably turned it around. If they had a tick. If they had had a tick near the center western expansion, it would have quite easily just stunned that entire raider force. And the commander had machine gun, I think. Machine gun or beam laser, it would have been fine.
I think it was the other commander which had the machine gun. That one just had a little pew-pew laser, which is why it went down so quickly. But, I mean, the moderators were moving into position. It's a shame to not see that moderator composition work, because on a smaller map like this, sometimes you can do that and just push out with a commander when you have two commanders. Push out with a commander, take territory that way, support it with skirmishers or something. Shieldbot often does that, where they sort of skip straight to Thuglaw or Rogues.
Yep. So I think this is actually it for the tournament. It looks like this is just going to be... the only round that's played. So one round tournament.
What?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I don't know. The brackets aren't even updated. I don't think the brackets even went live.
That's alright. It was a good match. Good set of matches. Really interesting. But the underdogs pulled it back.
Yeah, I mean, good on them. That was well done.
The
tournament actually hasn't
well.
Officially started even. And on challenge, I mean, the brackets weren't even officially started up. Oh, well.
Well, those games have been played anyway.
Yeah, so that was that. That was the October 2v2 tournament. I hope you enjoyed it. This is why I ask people tell people to sign up on the cast beforehand, because people... sign up, and then we get a nice big tournament. Honestly, big tournament. The amount
those
of time
were,
it takes...
Those were great games.
They were great
games. Those were
games,
great games.
But imagine if we had a tournament full of those games.
Yeah, the underdog made it out, excited. Yeah, no. I really enjoyed that. I think those were
good games. Those
were
good games. We're not going to complain about the quality of those games. They were well played. Well done to Anakin, Clone, Sprung, and Hokomoku, despite it saying professional never showed up. Hokomoko instead of Sprung. But yeah, that was at least well played. If nothing else, it was a well played tournament. Or well played set. So that looks like it's going to be it. Thanks everyone for watching. Thank you, Zaktoth, for helping me commentate. And have a good night, everyone.
Good night.
So yeah, that's...